this world famous up in that neck of the woods. It's been there forever. Okay. And here we go. So now we're into 53. This is a 10-mile race in Chicago, the Norwood Park handicap. They had it for about 4 or 5 years on a 1 mile circular course in the streets in Northwest Chicago that at the time they said was a testing track for automobiles in the 1890s and 1900 when they built these roads. And then the horse races were there for a while, and then it was paved over, and then we used to have the handicap races, and they would handicap limit, and I guess they had 5 or 6 fields. So if this is a scratch pack, and if you were at scratch and you were waiting over 2 minutes for the limit guys to come around, they would pass you. So if we expected to win a place prize, we had to get going, chase the limit guys down, catch the limit guys, shake them off, go past them, get rid of them, and then lap them if we wanted to get a place prize before the 10 miles were over. So you can imagine how hard we had to ride on track bikes with a fixed gear, and there was no mercy asked. I mean, it was tempo from the get-go. That's Frankie Berlando in first place, and in second place, that's myself. In third place is Tom O'Rourke from Detroit. On the outside in the black jersey is Sweet Strangberg from Kenosha. And sitting on me is fellow Hall of Famer Bobby Farr, 1950 national champ. And sitting on him is Al Stiller, 48 Olympic team. And in the back is Claire Young, who's Roger Young's father, who again was multi-time Michigan state champion and just a top category one bike rider for many, many years. Marine, ex-Marine kind of guy, a real tough guy, you know, that came along with Mike Walton and those guys out of the Detroit school. So that was a scratch pack. That's all we had, those guys, to catch everybody if we wanted to get 2 prizes. But we got past time, we're good for that, but we always wanted to get a place prize if we could too. So it was really no quarter drawn. I mean, it was like, out, we're on our way, get out of the way. If we don't come through, we're coming over you. Now here you go. This is the 1953 Elgin Road Race. Now by that time, they were riding fixed gears at Elgin Chicago, the 50-mile end-of-season classic road race, and we had then the road bikes that they let everybody ride road bikes, although some guys that were in the beginning categories were still riding track bikes. And here's a race that I'm in 5th place, and I still have a wristwatch I got for 5th place, but I had jumped these guys with about a mile to go, and Hartford Wagner, who's not in the picture, was a Minnesota state champion, and we went to Minnesota in the early in 53, and he wanted to win his Minnesota bike race where they had a big Grand Prix race, and we got humiliated and we blew him off and we beat him in his own bike race, and he was really a good rider. And then when I jumped the field, he says, "This is get even time, Ted," and he chased me so hard that the guys caught me with about a block and a half to the finish line, and then these guys came by me right before the finish, and Hartford Wagner, he just pull off to the side. He almost fell off the bike, but he says, "I got even with you, Ted. That's what you get for beating me in Minnesota." And I says, "Okay, Hartford, you got me." Well, that was fair and square. But it's Claire Young winning because he sat in, and then he just really had a good kick at the finish. I guess that Sweet Strangberg and Tom O'Rourke from Detroit, Olympic team guy, and then I think I was. Now that's Frankie Berlando next to me, and then that's me on the outside there towards the right, and then sitting in the back of you is Pat Murphy, the Canadian champion. So that's the finish of the 50-mile handicap bike race, and it was really it's a hard, hard race. So here you go, 53 store at Thumberville, and already the guys had ridden fixed gear before then. Now this is in the rain, and the guy on the left in the front is former Hall of Fame and Olympic committee member Ernie Seubert, famous, you know, bike rider, second in the national junior championship 1945. I mean, he's really well known across the country, and a big field all the way across the board, riding in the rain. Now you can imagine riding in the rain like this and going around a corner on a 1 mile course. So it was really dangerous with all the little tar strips and all that, but it was what it was, and everybody was going like crazy, and it was a good, tough race. And here's down the whole stretch. Yeah, you see on the left there, all that rough pavement. Well, it used to be cobblestones and streetcar tracks in the middle, and they paved them over by this time, so that the streetcar wasn't there anymore and the tracks were gone, but there was all asphalt and the bricks were over. It's just a rough, rough road in the center of that street, the big wide main street coming to the home stretch in downtown Somerville. And so now, of course, it's all paved over nice and smooth, but this was in 1953 when they had that really, for just only rained for, you know, about an hour or so, and then it got all dry and it was pretty good for the finish. Here's a women's race in 55. Now in 55, the guys were already always riding the fixed gear. Here you see how rough that street was in that section of the road with the cobblestones and the asphalt, all mixed pavement. But the women in their 10-mile race, and not that these guys were, you know, sexist or anything like that, the women had to ride fixed gears, but they meant to ride multi-speed bikes. The women in a 10-mile race and a road race, with the big 10-mile criterion, they were riding track bikes, but the men could ride the road bikes in a 50-mile race. So you got to add two and two together, and that was the sign of the times at that time. I don't think that would fly today, but that's the way it was in the 1950s. There you go. How about that for time capsule? Same year, Jimmy Rossi, five-time national champion. And you look at the old Metropolitan Shoe Store, and you know all the name Tommy Gann shoes and all that. This is a real time capsule of all the guys riding in the year in that age group. You see all the old bikes, all the new equipment, and the water bottles and the handlebars and all that stuff. So here you get a real action going back, still now transition from fixed gear into road bike racing in United States cycling history. And here you go, Sherman Park in 56. Now just that 1 mile course again where you saw the ladies in 1935. But here you go, this is 20 years later, still riding the same roads. And here's the men, and again, Jimmy Rossi in front, Al Stiller on the right, Bobby Farr, and I'm there on the left. And this is one of those knockdown, drag-out sprints, fixed gear, track bikes, big 1 mile park course, but you had to ride a fixed gear, no brakes. This was really top racing, you know, at its peak, when you're going, you know, riding 50-16, 52-16, or whatever gear ratio you had in these hard 25 and or 10 mile races in Sherman Park. And this is about getting towards the end of it now. This is 1961, same course, 1961. That first guy there, Don Giordani. The third guy in, the tall guy with the sunglasses, that's Victor Rossi, Jimmy Rossi's father. And he's holding somebody on the bike. But you see again, all fixed gear, all those no brakes, one speed, 25 mile scratch race. Usually had three races for the categories, two category B, two category C, and then the 25 mile open. And then this was that particular time frame. And that's what you had in the racing in Chicago. So that's, and of course, in the whole country. It wasn't any difference in Detroit or the difference in New York. They were all riding in the 40s and 50s, all kinds of just fixed gear type bike racing. So I guess, you know, we have a few minutes maybe. If anybody has any kind of questions, any of this kind of stuff, feel free to ask and I'll answer any question that I may have a little knowledge or insight of to just kind of share with you how our transition stayed here because of all the war years. The Second World War put the kibosh on a lot of cycling, so we never had any multi-speed bikes imported. Then along came Mal Pinto and my dad and Leo and the Walden guys in Detroit, Steve Bortolizzi. They started bringing in multi-speed bikes from France and from Italy, and then slowly it started going. Then towards the 50s, the touring people would ride multi-speed bikes, but the racing guys, they were pretty tight until the 100-mile Olympic trials and a few other races. It is said that in 1948, the American Olympic team guys trained and qualified and rode on fixed gear bikes, and they had never ridden a derailleur bike until they got on the ship where they had their Schwinn Paramounts with their 8-speed Simplex derailleur bikes, and they trained riding the rollers with their multi-speed bikes on the ship going to London to ride in the road race in London with a road bike. That's the first time the guys on the American Olympic road team ever ridden on a road bicycle. So that gives you an idea of where cycling was with its fixed gear phenomenon in the United States because of the wars and the Depression and us never changing, being way out here in America, away from the rest of the world, where the great big cycling activity was, Tour de France, Tour d'Italia, you know, guys all over the place, and they were riding multi-speed bikes, Simplex, Uray, Campagnolo, and we were still hung up on fixed gear bikes in all these races until then it slowly broke through. By the 60s then, it was breaking down all over, one race after the other, and then pretty sure it was all fixed gear except for riding on the track. All road bike and multi-speed except for riding on the track. Now the metal roads, they had to ride through fixed gear. All right, prices, anybody?
What's the biggest gear ratio you rode on a fixed gear?
Well, the biggest gear ratio that the guys would ride was usually 54-16. Just riding in a race, got in a sprint race, and then usually, because the tracks were 166 meters, a lot of small tracks, and the indoor tracks, so that track, the best cadence was like 52-16, which is like 26-8, and depending on what you rode. And then the cadence that on a road was like about 46-16, like about 74, gave you about the same cadence as the 52-16 did on the indoor track. So then the guys would train on a gear like that, get the same pedal motion action for the long distance riding at a fixed gear and at a single speed, then they'd ride that then on the track itself. But the guys, once in a while, when it came to just like a half mile or 1 mile sprint, they put on 108, 104 inches in it, put a big, and they just go quarter mile sprint, and they get off the bike and try to break the chain at a crank and get to that finish line a quarter mile up the road.
Can I tell them a little bit about blockchains and the different kind of chains they use?
Yeah, everybody understand the difference between a blockchain and a roller chain and what that kind of means? Anybody? Any inkling? Well, all the inch pitch chains, they made roller chains from 1900, but they got a lot of dirt in between the rollers, so the blockchain was freer and easier to clean. It actually had two plates and then just a block between the link. They had the space between the teeth. So then that way you had a block and then the space for the tooth with the two plates and another block. And then they were either a single piece of block or they were three layers of laminated chains. The Whipperman German chains were primarily three-layer chains, and then the Reynolds and I think the American Diamond chains and some of the other chains like I think Regina was a plate chain. Yeah, the other, they were real block chains. And they came 1 by 3/16 as compared to 1/2 by 1/8. They're just a little bit wider and a little bit stronger. You could jump a little bit quicker, but they're a little bit noisier. The roller chain was quieter, but had a little bit more friction. So the difference always in the ride and the style. And then the clickety-click with the block chain was always had more romantic of a feel for it. So that was kind of nice to hear the turning over the clickety-click when you always had your block chain when you were riding. And then, of course, it was so much easier to clean. You know, you just rock the damn thing off, and a lot of it was ready to go. With the rollers, you had to really wash off the soap and get all the grit and debris out from between the rollers and the rivets and stuff like that. Jake, yep.
What do you think?
Well,
you're really into Italian and French and the Japanese,
well, they, again, it was Paramount used the French parts first, and then they put Schwinn approved because they didn't want to promote somebody else's name at first, have to pay them royalty. But basically, Schwinn was the first guy to bring in, you know, that kind of stuff. But then all the other companies did too, and there was not enough of a market. The European market was big. So as a result, they could sell the stuff in Europe and around the world, but the American market for itself, there was just no money in it for an American company to tool up until SRAM and these other guys came along at a much later date. Wales came in for a while, but then they couldn't sustain it either. They made all these beautiful components on seat posts and pedals, but there wasn't enough of a market there to make that business viable over a long period of time. You know, different hot guys, stuff like that. But that's why they stick with the European stuff. It was there, the price was right, the dollar was strong, you could just buy it to the dollar advantage, so the stuff was cheaper to import and distribute here, rather than us developing our own market for that. And the fixed gear stuff was so prevalent that it was just didn't have any effect, you know, do that. Any other questions, anyone? Yes, sir.
Yeah, the distances in the 40s and 50s racing here in America, what were the longest distances of the road races, and what was the terrain like? Would you encounter mountain passes and tough terrain?
The American cycling scene was really strong in New York, and the German 100, which was held on in Long Island and through the rolling terrain, was still a fixed gear bicycle race into the 40s. Now, all of our races, because there weren't many 100-mile road races much, it was limited around 50, 60 miles. In 1937 in Chicago, there was the 100th anniversary of Chicago founding, so they had a 100-mile Milwaukee-Chicago road race. But what you did was ride through the Midwest, up and down these long grades and hills, but there was not much riding in Colorado, so you didn't have the mountain stuff. They were riding up in Northern California, but they were riding three steers up and down the hills a lot, the guys with their drag bikes and the free wheels and stuff, but they didn't race on them that much up in the hills. And then when you look at St. Louis, not many hills, New York area, not many hills, and Detroit, pretty flat, and St. Louis, that's where the guys were riding all these fixed gear bikes all the time. It was hills, but you know, quarter mile, 2 miles, 3 miles, grades and that stuff. But that's stuff you could negotiate on a fixed gear. You just had to step into it, push up and spin down. That's the way it was.
Did you do a lot of rocking on the ups and downhills?
I don't know anybody ever got off a bike and walked a bike racer. If you did that, you were disgraced. Yeah, unless you had such a big gear, you could ride up the hill. Yeah, touring people walk and get out in the country, you could ride up the dirt roads. But basically, we never got off the bike. You just had to suffer.
Yeah.
But that 48, 50-mile, 60-mile races, 25-mile race, that was the average long-distance road race. And then for an Olympic trial in the 40s, then they had the 100-mile road races. They start out 48 with the fixed gear, then 52, 56, then of course you had your multi-speed 100-mile. The trials and the finals were road race bicycles, so that was all limited to that. Yeah, but then the basic, then they slowly, that's when the cycling started to expand after the war, you know, when all this stuff kind of got continentalized, and then we started being more European in our attitude, and then the guys were bringing the bikes in, and then we started getting longer tours, stage races, but we wanted to ride a long road race, we had to go to Canada. You know, like the Tour of St. Lawrence, at that time I raced in 55. It was an 8-stage race in 4 days. Well, I was cross up and down the hills, you know, 2 stages a day. That was a 560 miles in 4 days. That was a hard race.
That was a hard race.
Yeah, that was a hard race. And then, of course, even had a big dirt road section in that, too. Well, we could have rode around with a bunch of guys this summer. Thanks a lot, you know, 3 miles of dirt road. But that was all right. That was a good race.
What were the rules on mechanical? Did you have to fix all your own?
Yeah, you could have a spare bike. You could have guys in the car following you along. You just had to catch up. You could change a bike. Except the Olympic trials, you had to fix your old bike and or you know, see what you had with your official stuff. But in all the other races, you could change whatever you wanted to do. Quebec, Montreal, 170 miles. You just rode on the highway between the two cities. And if you got a flat tire, you got to chase like hell and catch it. You couldn't catch it, tough.
What was some of the favorite diets for the racers?
Diets?
Seafood.
I know. Seafood, chicken food. Seafood, you gotta be careful, you get old fish, stuff like that, because a lot of guys got sick. But then on the other hand, a lot of guys used to eat tartar steak. Oh yeah, you get good fresh ground round steak, and they grind up really fine, and mix a little raw egg with it, and you mix that up. But onion was a little bad because of the liquid, you know, the onion kind of made you thirsty. But then you just had, you know, was tartar steak and stuff like that, soft leg. You guys used to eat raw eggs before the bike race. Then they cracked these eggs, just sucked the raw egg down, you know. And the guys would drink wine and they'd mix wine, water, and some other stuff together in a bottle, a couple of raw eggs and some wine. They just mix it up and drink that stuff down while they're riding. Hot tea was always a favorite. Chicken soup, if you get it warm, you could stop at a long race. I rode a 12-hour race in Pittsburgh back in the 50s, and at lunchtime, we'd stop for 10 minutes or 5 minutes. We just got off the bike, had a hot bowl of soup, and get a little cup of tea, and went to the bathroom, got back in the bike, kept on riding. But then, you know, it was down in a flat 3/4-mile course. If you can imagine riding 12 hours on a 3/4-mile course.
Jeez.
Right next to the river. You miss a turn, you're in the river. Well, there was a nice railroad tie to keep you going. But anyway, it's the kind of racing the way it was, you know. It was just good, hard, basic racing. And no team support. You had a car fall behind you. You could talk to him. You couldn't see him because you couldn't go back. You could go back and forth. It was nothing like that. You just had to ride in the group and chase.
Jerry-rig
their bicycles. You know, spare tire on your shoulder. You have that. And then, you know, they would wear a spare tire bag in the seat like everybody still does. And then, you know, they drill cranks out and seat posts out, and they try to shave the rims down and do all different kinds of stuff. Yeah, they liked whatever they could. And you just had to be careful, or they'll get breaks and stuff in that. You know, you had to watch what you were doing. But that's basically what people did. You know, they shaved all the way they could, got as light stuff as possible. Wood rings? Yeah, the wood rims were out about 1950, in that time frame, 48, 50. When I turned pro in 57, I had one wood rim left, and the guys came over from Europe, and I said, oh, look, Daddy, you took out one wood rim. And we're kind of joking about it. But when you look at that beautiful Resport water-based bike out there, the other guys wanted the wood rims, because years ago, they would ride larger tires on the cement tracks. And Continental made two size tires. They had a 1 1/8 inch tire they called it cement bond, which is cement track, because it absorbs a little bit more shock for the hard track on the old cement track. Then they made a 1 inch tire they called the Hulse bond, which was the port track. And that was a little smaller diameter because the wood track gave a little bit, so it brought a little smaller diameter tire. And then the wood rim would absorb the road shock, or the, you know, the shock of the boards a bit better, that it was a little softer ride when you were racing for 6 days, an indoor 6 day bike race. But then on the road, then the, you know, after a while after the war, the aluminum was so much more substantial, and you didn't have to worry about warping and keeping them tight and all that. So then by 1950 side time, all the guys had changed going to aluminum rims. You know, Giorgio Valencia was making American rims, and Fisto and Ava, all those rims, they were already being made then. You know, that time when Fiami came along, early in the 50s and that stuff. So that stuff was all being manufactured in that time frame. Sharon, the Weltmeister, the Sharon company, they were already making aluminum rims in 1936. And I think they may have been in the Berlin Olympics at that time. But they didn't bring any of those aluminum rims in until after the war, the Sharon company. Now, after the war, the Sharon family, yeah, I think they were in Berlin, they were pretty old after the war, then they sold their company to the Weinmann company. And then Weinmann took all the machining, and they didn't do anything with it for 3, 4, 5 years, and then they came up with the Weinmann sew-up rims at a later date. But those are copies then of the old Sharon's rims, and then the Woodfield rims. Those are copies of the original Sharon rims from before the war. And Sharon had 2 weights on standard and a Weltmeister and a world champion. That was a really lightweight rim. Well, you know, they made them down as low as 20 spokes. We're talking about tweaking. You rode that 20 spoke wheel, if you didn't start right, you folded that wheel in half. You know, no strength there, you see, years ago. The metallurgy wasn't there. But now the stuff, you know, they can ride 14 spokes, they think it's stronger than a house. So there's a whole difference in the technology and in the equipment that we're riding today versus what they rode years ago. Yes?
I have an impression that in the 30s, 6 day racing was a pretty big deal. Why did that screw? Why did that scene come back after the war?
Well, after the war, as big as a 6 day was, you could go to a 6 day bike race and stay all day for 50 cents. And the guys would take their food in and stick it in and whatever, they could almost sleep there almost all night. And as a result, there was a place to go. But it was the in thing to do because it was good entertainment, was hard action indoors, depression time, and it's what people were doing. Very, very famous. Europeans came over. The Americans, they wanted my dad to turn pro in like 36, 37. And then, because he was a pretty good bike rider. And he said, you know, we'll give you $45 a day. Well, they were paying Killian and Vogel and Torchy Pete and these, the Europeans and these guys, they were paying them $600 to $800 a day. They want the American guys to turn pro for $45 a day. Well, my dad says, well, he says, if I fall down or break a rim or a tire, I got to pay the manager for the equipment. He says, I'll end up owing you guys money. And sure enough, guys turned pro. They already wanted to see their name up there on the board, and they fell down and they broke tires, whatever they had. They had owned the management company. They couldn't get any money from the guys. So then they owned the management, and the guys wouldn't let them ride another race until they paid them off for the equipment for the prior bike race. So that's how tough the promoters were. But the Europeans, they brought over 6, 8, 10 teams, gave them $400, $500, $600, $700, $800 a day in their prime. They were making a big money, the Americans, until they got better. You know, to where like Cecil Yates and you know, Bill Jacoby and Crosley and Walthour and guys like that, then they were the top tier of the bike riders. They were making good money too.
Now, I was wondering if maybe in the 20s a lot of immigrants came over and whether their younger generation wanted to play American sports in the 40s and the 50s. And
no, a lot of them were bike riders. Because a lot of the guys, the first generation of immigrants, rode bike races. But they went into other sports too because they got Americanized. You know, they came here, they were avid cycling fans, but then that generation passed after the Second World War. So then that whole, you know, picture changed then after the Second World War, where people wanted to come back, have families, get started. They gave all that up. The cycling was, you know, was really on the back burner. And that's why it took so long.